I would like to point to the vital role of energy and electricity in taking people out of absolute poverty. Poor people need electric light so that children can study in the evening. Poor people need refrigeration so they can store food and store vaccines. Poor people need electric cooking so they can be freed of the scourge of wood smoke in poor homes. Now, we've heard Commissioner Piebags speak of sustainability. But unfortunately, when we use the word sustainable in this House, we actually mean unsustainable. And any efforts we make to deny access to cheap electricity fuelled by fossil fuels in the Third World will do huge damage. I am tired to death of hearing the proposition that poor people are most vulnerable to climate change. Nonsense. Poor people are most vulnerable to our policies designed to mitigate climate change. They will suffer if we do not make sure they have cheap and plentiful energy.
Hi, Carlo Bettirossi here, welcoming you to another interview offered by Atomi per la Pace. Today too I'm honored to introduce another exceptional guest. His name is Roger Helmer. He is a member of the EU Parliament and spokesman for the UK Independence Party on Industry and Energy. The short clip just shown, which doesn't need any further explanation, is one of the reasons, if not the main reason, why Atomi per la Pace asked him to have him on Skype for a nice chat. Then, of course, the interest of the UKIP for nuclear power generation specified in its energy policy did the rest. The viewer will find links to video footages and articles related to this interview in the description box below. Mr. Helmer, thank you very much indeed for accepting our request.
My pleasure.
Can you please give us an introduction of yourself?
Indeed. My name is Roger Helmer. I'm a British member of the European Parliament. I was first elected in 1999 as a Conservative. I moved from the Conservative Party to the United Kingdom Independence Party about 18 months ago, and I am now the spokesman on industry and energy for UKIP.
Okay, first question. Some time ago we read the news that some MEPs are pushing to close the Metsamor power plant, quotes, to avoid another Fukushima, end of quotes, here in Europe. Can you confirm this news, and in case it's real, can you tell us your opinion?
Indeed. I haven't been following this story closely, but it is my understanding that quite a number of MEPs have expressed concerns about this plant. That's the result, of course, of the anxiety across Europe following the Fukushima problem. We saw Angela Merkel deciding to close down the German nuclear fleet, and of course there is concern about nuclear power plants close to Europe's borders. Now, personally, I don't know any detail about Metsamor, so I'm not able to say, yes, it's dangerous, it should be closed, nor am I able to say it's perfectly safe, it should be left alone. I mean, it's reasonable that we should have an opportunity to check whether it's safe or not, and to offer perhaps assistance if it needs any upgrading. But I hope that we're not going to close it down just in a sort of knee-jerk reaction to Fukushima.
Don't you see it as a sort of intervention in a state which has nothing to do with the EU?
Well, indeed, and I think the EU should not be doing that sort of thing and making that sort of intervention. On the other hand, I think any country, if it looks at a situation close to its border and says this could be a serious problem or a disaster that might impact on us, it is entitled to say, can we sit down with that country and have a discussion about these concerns that we have? And I think any civilized country will say, yeah, by all means, let's talk about it.
Okay, second question. According to UKIP's energy policy program, contained in a leaflet with the title Keeping the Lights On, quotes, we could achieve Brussels emission targets more cheaply and more securely by a combination of gas and nuclear, end of quotes. Why do you think that nuclear needs to be part of the energy mix?
Well, I like to divide between what I call grown-up generating technologies, which would include nuclear, gas, coal, in other words, reliable, proven, large-scale technologies on the one hand, and on the other hand, what I call playground technologies, things like wind farms and solar panels that are intermittent and have very serious problems, and the energy they produce is unreliable and very expensive. And I believe that you need a mix of generating technologies. Both gas and coal are very good, but I don't think you're well placed if you only have one of them or two of them. I think you need to spread your risk, as it were, across different technologies. And I believe that certainly in my country, we should have gas, we should have coal, and we should have nuclear.
Are there other members of the UKIP that agree with you?
Well, I think within UKIP, there is very broad agreement. Certainly, I published our energy policy last October, last year, and I said essentially our policy would be to rely primarily on coal, gas, and nuclear, and there has been no dispute. Now, the issue that has come to the front in recent months is the issue of shale gas and fracking. And of course, there are concerns expressed. There's been a lot of black propaganda about fracking. The dangers, in my view, from all the evidence I've seen, are actually very slight and lower than the dangers with other technologies. But I understand that some voters are concerned and they need to be reassured. There will certainly be some people in our party who will question the issue of fracking. But our position as a party is we support shale gas.
Okay, next question. Which of the energy sources would UKIP put in the energy production mix, and in which share?
Well, the only renewable energy that in my view is both sustainable and usable and economically satisfactory is hydro. So I'm in favour of hydro, and the limit there really depends upon the landscape and the valleys and the rivers. If you can do more of it, we would like to do more of it, although you have to look at the impact on local people, local landscape, and so on. I mean, if you've got a town in a valley, you can't simply flood the town. We would not be subsidizing wind and solar at all. Our position is if somebody can make them economic, that's fine, make them economic. But we don't believe they are economic. The particular thing that the industry never admits but is a fact is that because renewables, wind and solar, are intermittent, you need conventional backup for when the sun doesn't shine or the wind doesn't blow. That imposes great inefficiencies on the backup because you have, let's say, a gas-fired power station, and instead of running properly, it is constantly being powered up and powered down. And held on spinning reserve and then powered up again. That's a very inefficient way of running a gas-fired power station. So when they tell you what the cost of solar energy is or the cost of wind energy, what they don't do is tell you the extra costs that are coming in through the backup.
Okay, next question. How does the UKIP plan to contrast the anti-nuclear movement in and out of the EU Parliament?
Well, we as UKIP are primarily interested in what we do in our country, although, of course, as long as we're in the EU, we have to take an interest in what happens in the European Union as well. I think the European Union is clear that member states have to make their own decisions on their energy mix, and you've got Germany that's threatening to close down its nuclear entirely. On the other hand, you've got France, which is, what, about 70-something percent nuclear. So to that extent, we can make our own decisions. Now, the problem in the UK is not so much the anti-nuclear movement, it's the government tying itself in the most hideous knots about how we should fund and finance nuclear development. The government is very clear, and rightly, that we need new nuclear power stations, but it doesn't know how to finance them. And I think the problem we have in nuclear particularly, but also in other forms of energy generation, is the issue of regulatory uncertainty. If you're going to build a nuclear power station, that nuclear power station is going to operate for probably 60 years. A modern nuclear power station should last 60 years. So you're making a decision, an investment decision, with a 60-year time horizon. Now, if you are the investor or you are the developer and you think that the rules are going to be changed in 6 months' time, 12 months' time, 5 years' time, it's very difficult to make a 60-year investment. So the fact that government can't think in terms of regulatory certainty for the investment period is the main problem. So far, the British government doesn't seem to have a very good idea about how to resolve that.
Okay, next topic. What do you think about the proposal to burn the UK's plutonium stock with the PRISM fast nuclear system developed by General Electric? Do you think that the plutonium stockpile is to be considered as a waste or rather as a fuel resource to be used to breed uranium?
Well, of course, plutonium can be used as a fuel. And if you have a choice between having a dangerous waste product sitting around or using it up as a fuel, then it seems to me the logic is to use it up as a fuel. Now, I should qualify that. I am the spokesman for our party on energy. I am not a nuclear engineer. I don't know the detail. And I would be happy to engage in a discussion about that with nuclear engineers who understand it. But my first reaction is to say, if it's there and it can be used economically, we should use it.
Why do you think that it's so difficult to let people understand that nuclear energy is not dangerous? How do you think it's possible to solve this problem?
This is a huge challenge. I mean, it all goes back to the fact that the moment you say nuclear, in people's minds, the word that pops up is bomb. You know, nuclear bomb, atomic bomb. And when you say nuclear power station, they find it difficult to dissociate that from the idea of a nuclear explosion. Plus, of course, there has been a series of accidents. There was Three Mile Island. There was Chernobyl, which is the worst one in terms of deaths. And now, of course, we've had Fukushima. Now, in the whole Fukushima event, many thousands of people died. But the many thousands of people died from the tsunami and the effects of the water. And my understanding is that only two or three people died actually in the nuclear power station. And that was from physical causes, you know, things falling on their head, not from radiation. Now, there has been and continues to be a worrying leak of radiation. And so one can't be sure how much damage might be done in the future. But what I think people don't understand is that if you look at, say, the coal industry, which we've been familiar with for 200 years, there have been, you can't get an exact number, but there have certainly been at least 250,000 people died in the coal industry. And on some estimates, people not in the industry but outside, ordinary members of the public, have also died of respiratory diseases as a result of emissions from coal-fired plants. We do it cleaner these days. If you look at the hydro industry, and this is a big surprise, I mean, Greens love hydro. We all think of hydro as being a nice, safe, cuddly technology. In fact, more than 250,000 people have died in hydro accidents, including 140,000 in one incident in China at Banquio, I think in the 70s. I would have to check the date. So in terms of human deaths, coal and hydro are hugely worse than any other technology. And nuclear on that basis is safe. I mean, nuclear is sort of strange, isn't it? If you're talking about, let's say, a gas explosion, you know what a gas explosion is. Maybe very horrible, but you know what it is. Whereas nuclear is sort of a mysterious, dangerous, nasty thing. And radiation is certainly nasty. But the actual track record of nuclear, the nuclear industry, even allowing for Chernobyl and Fukushima, is actually remarkably good. And so it's the job of responsible politicians and the industry to reassure the people, I think.
All right, thanks. Next question. Germany is considered the world's green laboratory. Unfortunately, most media tend to hide the face-off between a group of EU nations and Germany itself. This is due to the instability and volatility of the green sources. Would you please give us a comment on this?
Indeed. Well, I think that you're illustrating the problem with renewable energy. If you talk to people in the industry, network engineers and people like that, they will tell you that if you have 2 or 3% of your generating capacity is intermittent renewables, you can cope with that in the system. It's not a big deal. 5% is probably okay. 10%, you're starting to look at problems. Get up towards 20% and you've got very serious problems in balancing the grid. And that's why Germany is putting pressure on the Czech Republic to take some of their excess electricity and so on. I think Germany is a classic case history of what goes wrong when you pursue gesture politics and what I call playground technologies. And you let the Greens in the driving seat and they rush ahead with massive renewable investment. And the result is that Germany, which once had one of the most secure energy systems probably in the world, is now facing significant risks of power outages and certainly imbalances. Add to that the fact that Angela Merkel, in a knee-jerk reaction to Fukushima, decided to close down the nuclear fleet. My understanding is that Germany now, this green Germany that we've all had held up as an example, Germany is actually refurbishing or building 25 coal-fired power stations. American coal, as we all know, is cheap because shale gas has displaced American coal. And the idea that Germany, this sort of green figurehead that we were all so proud of, should actually be building new coal-fired power stations and increasing its CO2 emissions, I think is, well, bitterly ironic, and it shows what can go wrong when you let ideology run ahead of technology.
How is the EU Parliament supposed to solve this controversy?
Well, I don't think the EU Parliament can solve the problem. What we can try and do, what I can try and do as a member of the European Parliament, is to look at all the proposals that come through and try and amend them as far as possible in a rational way and explain to people why excessive reliance on renewables is a bad thing and why nuclear is essentially a good thing. But you know, the way things work in the European institutions, it is the Commission which starts out and has the sole right of initiating legislation. So if we're going to change legislation, it has to come from the Commission. And they do have a rather set of attitudes. And also, to be fair to the Commission, they do leave a considerable flexibility for member states to make their own decision. And there's a member for UKIP. I mean, I can quote Germany as an example, but I'm not going to tell Germany what it ought to do. What I will do is tell British politicians in London what they ought to do, because they're doing it wrong at the moment.
All right, last question. On February 9, 2011, Prince Charles held a speech to an extremely condescending MEP's audience regarding global warming and the fact that humanity is living above its capacity. Can you please describe UKIP's reaction to the speech and give us a comment?
Well, one of the nice things about the British monarchy, first of all, we all love it, and after various events that have happened recently, the Jubilee and so on, and the royal baby, we probably love it even more than we loved it 5 years ago. But we sort of allow our royal family to be a little bit eccentric and to have their own ideas, and that really is part of their charm. Some things that Prince Charles does, I absolutely admire. His commitment to the Book of Common Prayer and the King James Version of the Bible. I rather like his attitudes to architecture, and I very much like his watercolors. I just think when it comes to talking to plants in his greenhouse and talking green nonsense, you just have to accept that, well, he's entitled to his opinion, and he's got a platform. Fine, I'm entitled to my opinion, and in a small way, I've got the platform too, and we use what platforms we have.
Mr. Helmer, thank you very much again for your time and for being with us.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you very much for being in touch. Thank you.